Welcome to the next wonderful edition of Just Candid, a Chitkara University's initiative and web series with noted personalities, inspiring people, and great human beings. In fact, today I have a person who I had a personal privilege to interview a couple of years back, a gentleman, a thorough gentleman, and a wonderful human being. Ladies and gentlemen, friends and students, let's welcome Mr. Wendell Rodricks, the ace fashion designer of the country. Hello, Wendell.
Nice to meet you.
Likewise. Welcome to Chitkara. And what went behind your mind when you were already planning to come here and talk to our students and visit the university?
What went through my mind is what always goes through my mind as far as universities and educational institutions are concerned. When they ask me, I never say no. Because I believe that one should inspire them. We can inspire them with work. But I think we should also inspire them with one's life journey, which is what I did today at Chitkara University.
So students, you know, they are more tuned in and, you know, I would say groomed towards taking up jobs and all. You had a career from Muscat to India, to taking a clarion inside call of becoming a fashion designer, following your passion. From that days of struggle to Padma Shri, one of the noted laurels the Indian government could, you don't give it to anybody, somebody who's achieved as high as you. How is the whole journey and how has been the feeling by now?
I really don't have time to think about myself, because I think if you think about yourself, then you develop an ego, and I don't want to have an ego. So the only time I seriously thought about myself was when I was writing my second book, The Green Room, and that too was a challenge that was thrown by the Goa Writers Group. And I said, okay, fine, you know, I have to now write down what I went through in life. And that's when I actually began to think about myself. I think what I'm grateful for is the fact that life has been kind to me, life has been generous to me. And the biggest lesson I've learned, which I always tell students, is that, you know, teachers, university professors, parents, they want the best for their children, and very often that best is related to money. They want you to have a job that will ensure you earn X amount of money per month. And then you realize that, you know, like me, I was in hotel management. Of course I was earning money, and of course it was, but I was not happy, and I wanted my life to have a job that was not a job, that it was a passion. Which is why I switched over and joined fashion, because I knew that I would be much happier being in fashion than being in a hotel management job.
So you suggest the students, you know, that whenever that feeling comes in them, that frustration that whatever we are doing right now in our career is something not fit for us and this is what we want to do, they should not take it.
Yeah, I think, and also, you know, with the way modern life is, I would say, you heard my presentation down. I would say that, you know, if you get tired of a profession, like for example, now I'm not really interested in fashion. I love it, and I've given my brand away to my successor for 3 years, and she's handling it. But I mean, modern life and the world with the internet, whatever, such that you can change professions. I mean, I never dreamt that, you know, at this stage of my life, I would become a museologist. And I don't know, after I finish the museum, maybe I'll want to do something with a more spiritual bent. I think the opportunities are endless. And I think we should encourage our students that even though we are training them in one field, that not to hesitate to go after happiness. Because I think happiness is more important than money.
Brilliant. I think your magnanimity has always looked at the humane side of life to help people. You know, and you talk to our students while your talk was on about charity. You do every Saturday charity, as inspired by Simone Tata. And what is your message for students? You said do charity, but in what way they can do charity?
Do you know, when I give this talk to even school students. Sometimes they'll come and approach me after 5 years of hers and say, sir, you know, we heard you and we went. It can be something as simple as giving a poor person tuition in your area, or your, you know, the maid who comes to clean your house and her children are not that educated and they don't have anyone to help them, which with things that you are proficient with, like in English or Hindi or whatever, you can give them tuition. I give tuition sometimes to my tailor's children, and I feel you can do it in small ways. You don't really need to go and work with, you know, do grand things like Mother Teresa and work with leprosy patients or whatever. You can start in small ways. And I think the easiest thing is for students is to give tuition to fellow students. When I studied in America, we had what was called a buddy system, where I would help a buddy in the class and say, like, you know, okay, this person has come from Korea or this person has come from China. Their English is not so good, I'll teach them.
Wendell, the fashion industry has evolved. Mm-hmm. You know, I personally have been witness to it in a very small way for 6-7 years. The fashion weeks which have been happening and watching your displays and your work. How is it the career now, like for students, you know, if they want to take up fashion as a career, as a fashion designer, is it now gone tough or are there more opportunities open, or the nature of opportunities have changed?
I think it's gone tougher, A. B, it's gone easier on some ways. Depends which way you want to look at it. I mean, there are so many fashion colleges and there are too many graduates who want to graduate to become only designers. They don't realize there are other jobs like being a stylist, being a production manager, where you can possibly even earn more than as a fashion designer. So there are these other jobs that have popped up, which are, you know, which are very lucrative and very interesting and exciting. So I think what a college needs to do is to train students for the various jobs that are available at the moment. They do not focus on the all the jobs that are available. They'll only focus on the pattern making or the designing or the sketching or whatever. And then, like, you're leaving out this large swath of jobs that people can get. And I mean, it's styling, you can earn between 10 to 30,000 rupees a day. I mean, you know, and nobody offers a styling job. And then I think the mindset has to change a lot. It's what the business has become. It has thrown up so many opportunities. And I think it is up to, if I had to do a fashion college today, I would do it very differently, because I know what all is lacking. And I don't think that I would only train them to be fashion designers and good, you know, illustrators and good pattern makers or whatever.
How much would the industry play a role as a faculty when you open such a college or some new college as in today comes up? You know, how much role would the industry play and come and contribute, you know, even sort of giving them funds to, or giving them opportunities and internships?
I think firstly, don't take students, ex-students, who don't have experience. I think the college should take professionals who are working in the industry and just come to teach part-time. Because when they come to teach part-time, what they actually are doing is lending their professionalism, which is changing every day. I work in the industry, I know that if I am teaching, for example, history of world costume, from the time I taught it in 1988 to teaching it now in 2019, I would change the syllabus as it ran along, because I know that some designers have died, some designers become unimportant, whatever. But I see today, even in big colleges, I don't want to take names, but they still use my journals that I created in 1988, and that's useless. The syllabus in fashion has to be upgraded every year. There are new designers that come up on the market, whether they're working. If I ask a student designer, who is the designer at Balmain today, they don't know how to answer, because they've not heard of the brand, they've not kept in touch with the brand. When you ask them Yves Saint Laurent, they know, but Yves Saint Laurent is dead. So is Karl Lagerfeld dead, and so is Chanel dead. So one has to be on top of the game. And it's only the people who are working in the industry who aren't on the game.
Right. So coming to the end of our, you know, very short and wonderful conversation, I would say it's getting very candid. I would like to ask you that how lucrative is the career for students again upcoming to, you know, as in fashion? Shall they go in to set up their own industry as entrepreneurs? Or I would frame it like this, that is it important to do a few years as an intern or take up a job with a fashion designer?
Of course.
They can set up straight away? Or...
No, I would not recommend setting up straight away. It's like playing and gambling with your money. Because you have to learn through under somebody at least for 3 years, I would say maximum, minimum, and then go venture out on your own. But venturing out on your own is really not important. There are many other jobs that you can get.
So as you said, it is tough, but there are new opportunities coming.
Yes, it is tough because, I mean, how can the country create jobs for so many fashion designers who are graduating every single year from so many colleges? Earlier, it was only NIFT or SNDT, then now we have so many of them.
Yeah, a lot of design schools also coming up, just, I would say, a kilometer away from us. So we have the Footwear Design Institute come. So a lot mm-hmm. of things are coming in apparel design also, and the accessory design, you know, a lot of things are happening.
I can give you a vision of the potential, okay? Consider this, in the West, what do they have in fashion? They have 7 garments, literally only 7. A blouse, a pant, a skirt, a jacket, a cocktail dress, an evening dress, and a red carpet gown. That's all. And it gets over. In our country, in India, every single state, whether I take the Punjab, they'll have so many kinds of embroideries. They'll have so many kinds of costumes. They'll have so many colors. So you have these 29 states. I'm sorry, I think we're 28 now that Kashmir is out of the loop. So I think what we have is like there's such a large repertoire in this great country. When I got my knighthood from France, one of the reasons was that the Académie Française made me translate in French spelling all the different objects that we in terms of dress. You go to Kutch in which is one region of Gujarat. And it has so many, it has a KDI, it has this, it has that. And what does the West have? Why should we worry about the West? It's like very limited. And in that repertoire, in every state, students have to realize that they can push the boundary forward. They can take up one kind of embroidery, innovate it, make it superb. Why are we stuck with Lucknowi chicken work from the time of Noor Jahan? Noor Jahan bought her, when she married Jahangir, she bought her 40 Lucknowi stitches from you know, Iran, and we are still using the same stitches.
So it's time to innovate.
There's no motif, there's no embroidery thread change. Yeah, so I think students have a big job to go ahead. You've seen my presentation. You have to become
wonderful presentation. The house, especially the 450-year-old house.
Yes. But that is not for me. People looked at it and said, oh my god, 16 crores, you are just giving it away. And I said, but that, I can't take it to my grave.
That's what I mentioned, you know, your understanding about life and the magnanimity to turn it into a museum, which is for the larger benefit of the
Yeah, give it away. I mean, yeah. My life is now for charity.
So, last one is that you are unique, your designs are unique, you anyway are a unique human being, your thoughts are different and contributing. Any fashion designer you felt from the West or from India, you really admire in this
way? Yes, of course. I think the designer that I admire the most is Chanel. Chanel, as a woman, she knew what women wanted. When I teach history of world costume, I can pick out about 29 innovations. I think anybody that can make a big fat hat at the end of the 1800s into a single hairband with one rose, with one flower, sorry, camellia, is a genius. I think Chanel gave the modern woman everything. If women are wearing jackets today, they're wearing trousers today, if women are wearing what they wear today, they cut their hair short and, you know, get a suntan. All that Chanel gave us.
Thanks, Wendell, and look forward to see you more often campus.
Thank you.
Wonderful chatting.
Thank you. Same here. I'm going to tell all the students at Chitkara University what I just spoke at my presentation. Be true to your DNA. Use it. Be international. Be true to yourself in terms of giving your state and country something, and make us all very proud.